Hello, everyone. For some time now, you've been doing the 100 Days Sales Master Plan and the $10,000 in 1,000 Days Plan. Some of you have reached your goals within that time. Some have even finished early, while others are taking a little longer for different reasons. In the process of accomplishing a goal, a specific objective and concrete deadline must be set, otherwise some people might never complete it. This applies to everything we do and not just the Atomy business. Whether it is simple manual work or very complex mental work, a concrete deadline is a must if you want to meet your goals. For example, a doctorate candidate working on his thesis must have a detailed timeline for completing it. Otherwise, he could be delayed for any length of time before finally completing it. Some people are surprisingly lazy when working on their PhDs. When students set their goals to have their thesis approved within 3 or 4 years and work hard on them, most of them succeed in achieving that goal very close to the planned date. On the other hand, those who don't have a concrete timeline planned out are rarely able to finish in a reasonable time. In short, a concrete and specific objective is crucial when chasing your goals. Basically, you won't get the result you want unless you try your best. If you only work half-heartedly, it will be reflected in your outcome. I really want you to understand the importance of setting goals. If you could, please show us the slideshow for this lecture. The title of this lecture is Atomy People. People who work or have worked for Samsung take great pride in being called a Samsung man. The term Samsung man is used to describe a person who thinks rationally, works very efficiently, and is good at sharing ideas. Many very reputable organizations, including famous universities and well-known corporations, have carefully established their images to the public. I then thought about calling us Atomy men while trying to come up with a similar phrase. However, I decided against it because organizations such as Samsung tend to employ people by selecting people who underwent the training. These annually hired new recruits are generally similar in age, have like majors, and possess at least the general qualifications. Thus, it makes sense those employees would be called a Samsung man. Yet, since the diverse members of Atomy can come and go as they please, I felt that the term people was better suited for the company. Both people and man refer to humans as a whole, rather than being gender-based. During the IMF crisis, there was an article that was published in Korea. So, what was this column about? Well, it was a story about how new employees of famous Korean companies who were attending a training lecture in an auditorium like this reacted when a venomous snake slithered in. Upon seeing the snake, each company had a different response. People of Company A immediately attacked the snake with what they could find. I'm sure you can easily guess what company that was. They did whatever they could to kill the snake. Those from Company B weren't so eager to approaching it, and they decided it would be best to go ask their CEO about what to do. So they did just that. The new hires of Company C were cynical as they just sat and hoped that some smarter person would come and take care of it. Basically, these people dumped their responsibilities onto others and refused to show initiative by taking the matters into their own hands. Company D's employees decided to put their heads together and come up with a quick and effective plan. I bet that this company was Samsung. One organization even went as far as denying that the snake was there, even when others could visibly see it. They couldn't see the danger that was in front of them. Instead of seizing the moment, they just argued their case. This is the culture of a corporation, the leadership mentality of the CEO, and how the company deals with a situation will shape and form the corporate culture. Okay. We'll move on to the fable of the eagle. Many say an eagle can live up to 70 years or about as long as a human. It's an impressive lifespan for a bird. However, once it has lived about 40 years, the eagle is faced with a difficult life and death decision. By its 40th year, its beak becomes dull and bent, which makes it almost impossible to hunt for prey. Its once razor-sharp talons grow too long that they start to curve inward. Its wings become tattered with age, making it harder for the eagle to fly. Now, if an eagle can't hunt, it will die horribly of starvation. Wild animals and predators will die if they can't hunt. Humans are different, as we tend to take care for our elderly parents. Since animals don't do that, they have to hunt for survival. So, in this situation, the eagle seems destined to die. Yet, the eagle actually has two choices: starve to death or undergo a complete transformation by smashing its beak against a rock to break it off, and then waiting for a new beak to grow back. Then, using this new beak, it rips out its old talons so that new ones can form. With the sharp new claws, the eagle plucks out its old feathers. Once the new feathers grow back, it can live well for another 30 years. In order to earn another 30 long years, the eagle must suffer through 6 brutal months. Basically, eagles must endure a painful metamorphosis period if they wish to dramatically increase their lifespans. Assuming that we will retire at the age of 60, we still have 30 more years to live. Due to the advancements in medicine, we might live to 100. Those who are very unlucky might have to live up to 120. Just like the eagle, all of you have two choices: go through a complete transformation to live a good life, or continue to struggle for the rest of your life. It's your responsibility to choose between the two options, just like how the eagle did on its own. Thus, unless you endure the painstaking process of changing yourself and your thought process, you won't be able to have a life full of vigor like the eagle. Next is, people are the most important factor of production. As we went from the industrial to the information age, people have become the most important factor of production. Traditionally, the three factors of productivity are land, labor, and capital. Although manual labor was vital in the past, mental labor is now considered more valuable. Many economists and scholars have agreed on that aspect. Maybe that seems strange, so let me explain why. In the past, people could become wealthy by owning lots of land, big factories, and several different businesses. Today, many of the world's richest people, and especially those who were originally poor, do not necessarily own lots of assets or properties. They became wealthy on their own. Let's take a look at Bill Gates. He's not famous for owning lots of businesses or factories. Nevertheless, he's the richest person in the world. According to the latest data, his fortune is estimated at $72 billion. His business is located in Seattle, Washington. Although he is retired now, he only had his brain to help him build that fortune. Next is Warren Buffett. He runs a company called Berkshire Hathaway. What does this company do? It's an investment company that trades stocks and bonds. He is the second richest person, whose fortune is estimated at $60 billion. Don't even think about counting to 1 billion. You would never be able to finish counting that kind of money. I'm telling you, it's impossible to sit down and count to a billion. Next up is Mark Zuckerberg. the founder and inventor of Facebook. He is only 27 years old. His fortune amounts to about $30 billion without land or buildings. His brain power made him who he is today. You've all heard of Joanne Rowling, right? She used to struggle to survive on welfare as a single mother of one daughter. Up until now, over 450 million copies of the Harry Potter series have been sold worldwide and 7 films have been made. The profits from the films alone have reached about $7 billion. So, in 5 short years, she literally went from rags to riches. It took her merely 5 years to become super rich. She started out by sending the manuscript to 12 major publishers, all of whom turned it down. Fortunately, one American publisher took a great liking to the book and advanced her about $120,000 even before publishing it. That American publisher immediately recognized its potential. What do you think might have happened if those 12 publishers had instead recognized the book? They would be raking in money today. That is no longer possible for them as that American publisher took it. This teaches us a moral about the importance of recognizing a diamond in the rough. J.K. Rowling is one of the richest people in the world. Her fortune is estimated to be about $1.5 billion. She bought a castle, remarried, and now lives happily. Another example is seen in the Jewish people. They had it tough because they didn't have much, and they were persecuted wherever they went. Nevertheless, the world-class wealthy are mostly Jewish today. They own most of the biggest financial companies, publishers such as the New York Times or the Washington Post, auction houses, and diamond dealers. They are not big property owners. The Talmud tells Jewish mothers to teach their children this. The Jewish have had a long history of persecution and migration. Their civilizations and properties were often looted and seized. So the mothers asked their children, "If our house is invaded or set on fire, what would you take from our home?" The children answer that they would take the jewelry. Jewelry is easy to carry, right? The mothers tell their children, "Jewelry can be stolen too. The only thing no one can take from you is knowledge. As long as you have knowledge, you can still survive." In short, the Jewish people believe that knowledge is the only true capital, since assets such as cash, property, or businesses can be taken away by others. The Jewish show us the importance of human resources as capital. Another example can be made with the Atomy contractors. Since our bodies themselves are our greatest capital, once we use them to increase productivity and make them highly productive, we can all become rich. There really is no other choice, right? Let's take a look at the talents required in these changing times. There have been agricultural, industrial, and information age. During the agricultural age, one-dimensional talent was all we needed. So, what is one-dimensional talent? Well, knowing just a little bit about a wide range of subjects guaranteed a comfortable, respectable living. Farming doesn't really require highly complex knowledge, right? In those days, as the technology wasn't really very advanced, and most people didn't travel very far or even travel very often, people with college educations were treated with respect. Neighbors would say, "Wow, he's a college graduate." An ordinary but broad education ensured high productivity, which in itself guaranteed success. During the industrial age, this kind of generalized education was no longer very useful. Instead, expert knowledge was required. This expertise would then bring about high productivity. In areas such as electronics, chemistry, or automobiles, expert knowledge is necessary. Time constraints made it impossible to generalize. So, one-dimensional talent was no longer enough.
However, that still wasn't enough for the information age we are in. In this period, all fields of technology are merging. Automobile technology involves mechanical engineering. Yes, mechanical engineering alone can't create cars. Electronic, computer, chemical engineers, and quite a few others as well, all have to be involved in order to produce a car. Nowadays, even biological engineering has joined the process. Thus, a cross-shaped symbol was used to signify that one must possess not only a deep level of expertise in one field, but also a more generalized knowledge of related fields to survive. This is happening in the U.S. right now. Natural and social sciences have now become one, since business becomes harder if they weren't. The same thing is taking place in Atomy as well. Although most refer to this as a cross-shaped talent, Toyota used the first letter of its name and started calling it a T-type. To keep things simple, we will just refer to this concept as the T-type. Whether it is a cross or a T, a wide range of general knowledge and a deep level of expert knowledge in one field are both necessary to succeed. Let's say a mechanical engineer builds a machine that works perfectly without flaw. If that machine lacks a very attractive design, it won't sell well. These days, people buy products based on design rather than function. Thus, we have humanities, aesthetics, and the arts. So unless all of these are combined, it becomes difficult to do business. You might wonder what kind of talent is expected of an Atomian. I believe that Atomians should be A-type people. The letter A looks very similar to the character for person in Chinese. The A looks like two people relying on each other to live. However, rather than just relying on each other, we have to communicate with one another. Communication results in cooperation, which results in creating a superorganism. Individual efforts can never lead you to lasting success. A-type people must always be communicating with one another. This A is also shaped like a ladder. So, it can represent the ladder of success that you can climb. However, it's only possible when a bar helps brace it up. In short, communication is the key to success. So, as we learned, a person needs a vast amount of knowledge. We can call this being a liberalist, so why is that important? Well, in reality, an accountant at a firm should be the expert bookkeeper, because they would be speaking with other people in that field, rather than the people in marketing. What about Atomy contractors? We have to meet with all kinds of people. We have no idea what kinds of people we might encounter and deal with every day, or what ideas they might have. That's why you need to be a liberalist and have a wide range of knowledge. You can obtain this by coming to the seminars and having exchanges as you meet with your sponsors and partners. That's how you gain general knowledge. All you need is a strong interest. Even if you simply drive past a sign, as long as you pay interest to it, it can become valuable information. If you don't pay any attention, then it becomes meaningless. If you are not a liberalist, you are going to feel very limited when doing this business, because you're going to have to deal with all sorts of people. We need to become specialists as well. Not only do you have to be an expert in marketing, Atomy products, Atomy business, consumer behavior, and consumer psychology, but you must also know the methods of developing your downlines and the 8 steps to success. You must be an expert in them. No one is born knowing about or understanding all these concepts. We learn about them as we live our lives. In that learning process, effort is required. Hence, being a specialist is very critical. Lastly, it is important to have communication. It's simply impossible to do this business alone. It can't be done. Success only becomes possible when there is cooperation. However, you need to have communication for that to happen. Without communication, it becomes impossible to form a superorganism. When this happens, no ability in the world will help you achieve success. That's why communication is so important in this system. Only through communication and cooperation can knowledge and information be shared and exchanged. Scholars have pointed out that unlike capital or labor, knowledge becomes greater the more you share it with others. Ordinary goods vanish quickly if shared with other people. However, information multiplies when shared. It stays with you and grows over time. Thus, communication and cooperation give birth to the concepts of the superorganism and the collective intelligence. This collective intelligence is a collection of people's knowledge, which, in essence, can be used to overcome any challenge. An individual can't do that, no matter how smart he or she is. Individual intelligence can never rival a collective one. That's just the way it is. That's when a synergy effect is created. Synergy effect simply means that the effect is greater than the sum of the individuals within it. Synergy can only happen when we are working together. There is also a counter-synergy effect, which is something that is less than the sum of its parts. Counter-synergy happens when individuals are micromanaged, or when people aren't willing or able to cooperate with each other. Peter Senge, a world-renowned scholar in organizational learning, came to this conclusion. He observed that when a group of 160 IQ were made to work together, the result of this group only equaled a collective IQ of 60. That's what happens when you don't have cooperation. When team members don't respect each other's abilities and efforts, even highly intelligent people will only produce disappointing results. When people of normal intelligence come together to form a superorganism and utilize the collective intelligence, they are able to obtain impressive results. This is the conclusion that many scholars came upon after much research. Thus, cooperation is always the best strategy. I have talked about game theory in the past few seminars. Many game theory experts tried to come up with the best strategy to produce the highest income, because life itself can be seen as a game, right? They wanted to choose a game theory that produced the best outcome in any given situation for everyone. And the cooperation-first approach came out on top. In other words, strategies that encouraged betrayal always performed the worst. Okay. There is a proverb that explains why communication is necessary for cooperation and forming a superorganism. In the Great Commentaries 1 for the Book of Changes, the proverb is summarized as close friendship. The first part reads, "But when two men are one in heart," what happens when people are of one at heart? It continues, "Not iron bolts keep them apart." This proverb ends with, "The words they in their union use, fragrance like orchid plants diffuse." So, when two people put their minds together and work as one, not only can they cut through metal, but also become as fragrant as an orchid. In other words, cooperation will make everything possible. Ultimately, we need to walk in someone else's shoes. Our goal is to obtain both general and expert knowledge, and to grow by communicating and cooperating with one another. To do this, we need to walk in someone else's shoes. A similar proverb appears in the Mencius. So what does this proverb mean? Well, it wants us to change our perspective. Simply, if you put yourself in someone else's shoes, how would you act? The maxim is appealing to our reason. Just thinking reasonably is not enough. So I added the concept of empathy, which means you need to feel it too. Not only do we need a cool head, but also a warm heart. Since it might be hard to just change perspective and have empathy, you need to act in consideration of others. As such, rather than complain about my lecturing style, you need to come up here and see for yourself how hard it is. Instead of criticizing someone's driving, you need to see how difficult it can be. This also applies to everything, even sales. Try doing sales yourself to see how hard it is. Otherwise, you won't understand how the other person feels. If you only walk in someone else's shoes, it will be very difficult to become a united heart. You need to empathize with your warm heart. See for yourself how hard their lives are. Some have many mouths to feed. Some barely make ends meet. Don't just try to relate to them by looking back at your past. You need to experience it by working together with your partners. Therefore, change your perspective by walking in someone else's shoes, empathizing and acting in consideration of others, and work together to become a superorganism. If you do so, you will all be making 10K a month within 1,000 days. I am absolutely sure that you can achieve this. I hope that you all achieve big success. Thank you so much for listening.